Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. Sorry there for the little bit of a delay at the start. We had a little bit of a technical error, but we are live now. So if you're tuning in live, be sure to let us know where you're watching, where in the world you're watching this from. We always love to connect with you guys. And so we're live right now on YouTube as well as Facebook. And both streams seem to be perfect, running smoothly, so we can move forward with our intro sequence, and then we'll welcome Jochen into the session today. Hi, Jochen. Welcome to the Mary. Session today.
Hi, Mary Claire. Good to see you again, or hear you again.
Yeah, nice to hear you too.
Yeah, for various reasons, we choose not to put our cameras on, but it's all about the Livestream Lecture today about shoulder freedom. And I think it's a great topic. But before I get going on this, are you all set for Christmas?
Oh my goodness. Yeah, I have one more gift to buy actually for the Schleese Secret Santa that we're doing next week. So I'm still racking my brain as to what to get for the group, but that's my last gift. Yeah, but I'm all set otherwise. How about you, Jochen?
Very good. It's starting to feel more like Christmas here because we finally got some snow and it's still snow heavy. How about you? Is it in your area too?
Oh my goodness. Yeah, we're getting tons of snow up here right now. Yeah.
Okay, it's just a short little half hour. So why don't we start with today's live stream and take from there.
Sounds great. Take it away.
All right. So hello, everybody, and welcome back to my live stream. And everybody who has seen this before, welcome back. And for you guys who've seen this the first time, my name is Jochen Schleese. I'm the founder of Saddle Fit for Life. That's an educational company and for the manufacturing company Schleese Saddlery Service. I started my passion with horses when I was very, very young boy. My dad taught physics and math in various countries all over the world. We were back then in Buenos Aires, Argentina, and there I saw a person riding on the horse, and it was mesmerizing how man and horse can be synced as one. And from that moment on, I wanted to be a horseback rider. I was only 6 years old, and that's all I wanted to do. Here you see my horse, Pirate is his name, and he was a 17-3 Hanoverian, super athletic. This was my first international three-day eventing. He won the German championship. And we were qualifying back then to the European Championship. And you can imagine that this topic for me today, shoulder freedom, is quite near to my heart. Because if my horse wouldn't have enough shoulder freedom and would knock the solid fence, we would somersault. But shoulder freedom and engagement can mean so many things for so many people. I found this picture on the website and I thought that was quite well demonstration, how when the horse lifts his leg and points forward, you can see the girl's holding her finger where the shoulder blade was before, how much a shoulder can actually move back. Depends on the breed, depends on the ability and angles of the upper arm and the shoulder. The shoulder blade can rotate quite a bit back. You see this huge bulge right here. And I always wondered, you know, when people talk about shoulder freedom, what are we to really try to free up? So this is a video I've shown often in my presentation. You can see here, let me just take that sound bar down a little bit. There you go. There you go. Oops, that's not what I want to do, but here we go. So here you can see how the shoulder blade loads and then boom, it slides back. There was the momentum. But I also find it very fascinating how much in this area the tricep contracts. Now here we see the rider sitting quite big back from the withers. You wouldn't sit there when you're at all the time. But it's a great picture to identify what's going on in the shoulder, tricep, trapezius, rhomboideus, splenalis, all these areas would work in that area. And when you picture now a saddle on top of that, okay, a saddle is girthed right over this area. And the rider sits on top, the girth is on top. How can he see in the video stuff how that muscle contract? How can all this free up? Now, there's various movements and gaits and tools we can measure shoulder freedom or pressure. Here, the rider is riding, and the saddler fitted the saddle as good as they can. And via Bluetooth, it signals the pressure. And like you see here is a simulation of the horse's back. You see there's always pressure under the gullet plate and the stirrup bar. Now, various sports and different sports, they want the shoulder really to move up. Okay, so in the saddle industry, they call it the hyperextension fit. Saddles are made up to 26 inch long. So the smallest would be 19 inch. And for dressage riders, event riders, or jumper, you would think 19 inch. Oh my God, that's a huge saddle. That is in this industry the shortest saddle. They go up to 26 inch. Here, what is meant to do is that the rider sits way back in an area where it is super difficult for the horse, but also nicknames false elevation. Here, the horse is doing a walk, and you can see how the horse is able now to lift his leg all the way up. By cranking the head up, back, the horse does these insane movements. Now, the rider sits way far back, kind of like in the video, what I just shown, and rocks the saddle away from the front. And then we have other sports in the modern dressage sports, even though in the FN clearly shows when a horse is doing circus trot, in other words, the front leg is way higher than the back leg, that they are getting marked or disqualified. Today, we see all kinds of winners with that horrible trot. It's getting better, but there was a huge talk about hyperextension or roll cure. Here, it's even harder for the horse because the head is down behind the vertical and the rider is trying really, really hard to get this false trot or circus trot, also known. So there's numerous people who been on the German Olympic Committee who were veterinarians, so I'm still veterinarians, who point out how much this type of riding is really damaging the horses for life. And not only is he a veterinarian, he's also a rider. So his first job, he was trained as a professional trainer. And he knows from his training, as well as from his studies to become a veterinarian, how the horse is supposed to work and how the horse can be very easy damaged by having a hollow back, hind leg is way out, and the horse is going hollow, but shows the shoulder movement. That's not that kind of a shoulder freedom most people talk. They don't want to do it to the horses, because when you test their back, you look at the back, you see here's the horse from the top, you're looking from the back, you see this, there's hardly any pressure in the middle, and a lot of digging in the front and in the back. So the horse has a lot of issue in the lumbar area. The saddle showed a lot of pressure in the front. So once again, you don't really get a lot of shoulder freedom if the tree is too narrow or doesn't fit right, or it's made in the sense that the horse gets this extra flick, that we call it short trot. From different universities around the world, this is coming from the University of Zurich, they talked about the area here, dry spots or wrinkled skin or atrophy. Most of the time we start seeing white hair in the front and white hair in the back, just like you see here in the thermography. You see pressure points there and there. So what does it really mean? How do we get shoulder freedom and how do we stop the pinching? This picture here shows you the cranial nerve 11, what goes through the trapezius. Sometimes you see this line right here. Okay, so people say, oh, that's the fit line. Or they say, oh, that's when the horse is outside and in the summer, they shake off all the flies. That's a fly shaker sign. Now, sometimes you see that and there is no fly shaker. There is a massive pinching behind the shoulder. And just like previously, all this here is atrophied. Okay, so we need to understand these are all nerves what coming up. And sometimes they get pinched nerve. There's other body workers who specialized in that aspect. But today we want to talk shoulder freedom, and we want to talk what the industry has perceived or has done when it comes to saddle fitting and shoulder freedom. It goes that far that veterinarian publicly on video show the horses will have long-term damage if this here, this is the saddle tree. This horse, obviously dead, dissected, skin is off. Here you see the saddle tree. Here shows the veterinarian that the distance from D-ring to D-ring is not wide enough. And that metal, some companies have the metal point sticking out on the bottom, does not help shoulder freedom. All what it does, it cripples and damages the cartilage, what is on top of the shoulder. How do we now achieve shoulder freedom? We know when the leg goes forward, that upper arm pushes the scapula upwards, backwards. So we want it nicely coming through and not damaging with saddles what have two short tree points or tree points what pushes forward. So the easiest way to explain it is think about your elbow. You have on your elbow a funny bone, and that funny bone is not funny at all when you hit it. You feel it all the way to your pinky. You don't have to hit it. You can just feel around your elbow. There's a little groove. And when you find that spot, it's very easy and you can feel like an electric shock. It goes all the way to the pinky. So these reflex points or areas where the horse reacts to it, it's not often what we want to do purposely. We don't want to have the horse going pace. If it's a dressage horse, right, you get marked down if you don't have a clear walk. And you don't want to have the horse hollow, because we know what that does to the spine. And we also don't want to wreck the shoulder cartilage like I just showed. This one here where my mouse is right now, that's a lung meridian point. BL13 is the lung meridian point. And we all know when the heart rate is artificially raised and excess of cortisol is in our blood. And what does that mean? Easier for the horse to get colic and ulcers. Of course, we don't want it. We talk about shoulder freedom. How do I get shoulder freedom? For hundreds and hundreds of years, that pink bar is the middle of the longest muscle. Right here would be the pink bar. The longest muscle, longissimus dorsi, ends at the hip and starts at the bottom four vertebrae of the neck. Okay, right in the center where the belly is the where the muscle is the biggest, we call it the belly of the muscle. That is where the saddle needs to sit. If it doesn't sit there, the horse will react negatively. When I say negatively, it's like B, okay? It will brace itself, goes hollow. So if you look at the landing leg here, you see the fetlock is very close to the ground. It's a little bit higher. What are we trying to do? What is engagement? You want to have the horses back up, haunches underneath, so that that hind leg comes more underneath the sternum, and then the horse becomes lighter. Then the whole trunk lifts without artificially pulling it down, like I showed you in the previous pictures. We want that back to come up first to get the leg underneath. So we need the horses back up in order to engage the hind leg. And especially on young horses, we need to train the hind leg. We need to train the back muscle before I ride the upper level. If you don't have a strong enough horse in the back and in the hind leg, the horse will never have shoulder freedom. So what do I need to know? I need to know that my saddle has areas from D-ring to D-ring. Here you see the D-ring. Most of the time, that's where the panel right here, the front panel, we call that the vertical panel. And the panel that goes along the spine, we call it the horizontal panel. So the front panel starts most of the time where the D-ring is. And from that point to that point, that distance we call the tree width. So look at this area here. These drawings here, they have all red tree angles. They're all in the same angle, but the tree width, narrow, medium, wide. They're all different width. In this example here, I have all the same tree width with a dotted line goes all the way through, but it's a different angle of the tree. So we need to understand for the horse to have proper shoulder freedom, I need to select the right tree width and the proper angle of the tree point. We call it tree angle. Because what I'm trying to achieve, is that I do not pinch the spinalis trapezius and rhomboid. These three muscles on top, okay, they get very, very quick injured or, well, blistered sometimes or atrophied if the saddle doesn't fit properly. So dry spots, okay, very large dry spots, you see very often where the saddle has a metal plate. And often if the metal plate, is it too narrow in the tree width? This here, the horse needs this, but you have a saddle what is only that wide. Or is the angle too wide and the bottom doesn't touch? Okay, so angle of the saddle tree is easy to measure. You can take just a digital angle finder. They're super, super inexpensive. They're like $19 on the internet or something like that. And you can get that. The old angle finder, this tool is over 100 years old. What we're looking for, you look at the line where the pen lies, has to be parallel with this unit or with the horse's shoulder blade, okay? If it's not the same angle, you will hit one of the negative reflex points, and you can see how wide the saddle is from here to here. So this is a typical saddle, a wide tree width with a steep angle. So your saddle fitter will maybe say to you, oh, your horse needs a narrow, wide tree. If you just say it like that, that's super confusing. But if you say it, your horse has super broad chest and very broad shoulders, you need a wide tree width, but the shoulders on that horse, they are very steep. So you need a steep angle. This is the opposite. Unfortunately, it hides a lot of the panel, but this is a narrow tree width with a wider angle. Okay, so very important to know the difference. If I have a saddle that fits properly in the angle and in the tree width, but I still don't have enough shoulder freedom, there's a way how you can decrease the pressure on the front of the saddle. This is your traditional stirrup bar, which is always riveted on the gullet plate. And every time you do your two-point, is it canter or is it an endurance rider or event rider? You are putting all your weight in that area. Even as a dressage rider, when you warm up in your rising trot, that's where the pressure is. There's another CB stirrup bar. This is the bar we patent, and it just came through. It's attached in the middle, hangs in the front, and has no pressure whatsoever. So you now decrease the pressure in the front. Also, you have saddles with the forward tree points or straight tree points. That makes absolutely no sense to me. Then when you look at the shoulder blade is round and goes backwards. Here is very well explained the BL13, that's a bladder meridian point 13. If your saddle slides forward or you have a saddle where the tree points go forward, you're constantly hitting that point and that horse has an elevated heart rate. If you're a competitive rider, dressage jumper, eventer, polo player, why would you want to have a horse but only runs on half of the tank? So long-term, even if you're just a pleasure rider, the horse has unnecessary stress, and we know what comes from stress. So it is absolutely important to understand, if I ask my horse to have shoulder freedom, okay, I can choose a certain stirrup bar, what helps it, or I can get a saddle where the tree point goes back. You see most of the time where the panels are cut out like this. Right from the bottom, it looks like this. And the flap would be obviously very forward on the jumping or extreme forward on the eventing or straight on in the dressage. But what touches the horse and what frees up the shoulder is this area. Another big important part is, how do you get shoulder freedom? If you pay attention where the horse's mane is. 7 out of 10 horses have the mane go to the right. 7 out of 10. 2 have the mane go to the left. 1, the mane splits absolutely in the middle. Sometimes you have a horse where the mane goes to the right and the front part goes to the left. I recommend you speak to your veterinarian, chiropractor, physiotherapist, osteopath. Most likely these horses are out of alignment in their neck vertebrae. Most of the time, C3 or C4. So if I have a horse what has so much atrophy from the previous saddle, how can I make sure that I not put more damage and that shoulder blade can come through in movement? You have to make sure that your saddle stays in the center, okay? Which means when you jump, okay, you'd be surprised how many people hang to one side in the air or doing landing. Why is that? Horses don't have, like humans, a collarbone and have one side more developed than the other. Now you could say, hey, people are stronger on the right than on the left. Yes, the majority are. So is the horse. And why did I talk about the mane? Because the higher side will always push the mane comb to the hollow side. So this horse here, mane goes to the right because the left shoulder is much bigger. So make sure the saddle sits straight. Left and right of the spine has plenty of shoulder freedom. It has been said that the average horse has a hand width. So from this bone to this bone, wide spine. You do not want to sit on the multifidus, on the spinal processes, on the ligaments of the horse. That's why saddle makers have these channels. Unfortunately, sometimes they are way too small. This saddle here is very, very small, 3.5 fingers. That is not 4 inches. So all old saddles, cavalry saddles, they always have a nice wide spinal clearance. If you ignore it, thermography shows you up, and you have issues with the horse. We talked about that briefly. Kissing spine is when the horse's back is sinking and all these spinal processes touch. And when bone hits bone, it grows bone or it calcifies and it locks. That's the last what you want from your horse. You don't want to see that type of deformity on your horse. What else do I need to have when I want shoulder freedom? Now remember, your horse goes to the growth stage and the serratus and the pectoralis get wider, and then you see it when you brush your horse. All of a sudden, you put your brush between the front legs, go left to right, says, "What's that horse now? Look how wide he gets." But the shoulder gets steeper and it gets wider. Okay, behind the shoulder, the saddle sits on the trapezius and the longissimus dorsi. Okay, you want to make sure that you have space for the muscle and the shoulder blade to come through. This would be horrible because when you sit down, girth it up, you pinch the wither muscle, the trapezius. Here, the weight is on the longest, strongest muscle, and it bridges this muscle what can contract. If you look back in the old times, how saddles are made, they're made most of the time wider in the center. Why do they have to be wider in the center? Because if the horse is ridden properly, shoot properly, and he's healthy, and you look at the spine of the withers here, okay, and in the middle of the longissimus dorsi, where the saddle panel sits, the front saddle area should only touch to 30%. 40% where the spinal processes are straight, that's where the most pressure should be. And in the back again, 30%. Then people say, well, that doesn't work because now the horse, the saddle rocks. If you can ride the horse by bringing up the back, it's a very simple exercise. This saddle here creates easy shoulder freedom. This saddle, almost impossible. Let me show you. You can see on this picture here, we started this seminar with this picture here. And the question was, how can we put a saddle on without squishing the muscle? Well, if you correctly fit it, you can see on this here, okay, you can see how that muscle contract and elongates and how it can slide easy underneath. This rider who shot these pictures jumps this horse 1.50 meters. It doesn't go backwards, it doesn't go forward, and it doesn't rock. If we look at this picture from the front, you can see how the saddle slightly touches here and slightly touches there. And just like you, when you swim through the pool and you do breaststroke, okay, your shoulder moves. If you crawl, your shoulder almost rolls. You can see with a complete shoulder freedom, the shoulder rolls, stays away from the area, and the horse can easily move through. Today we have technology what measures the horse's back with your phone. It's a very, very easy app. It's for free. The way the company makes money is by you paying for the measurement of those images. The cool part is, without you paying a penny, you can see how much wider your horse gets, and you can rotate this. It's very, very cool. The other way you can see if your saddle fits right short without a saddle pad, and you can see, I'm going to blow this up a little bit. You can see here's the shoulder, and all this area is free when the shoulder rotates, and the rest, this looks like the coat has been ironed with an ironing board. Okay, super even weight-bearing surface, no hair is ruffled. If you ignore it, the horse will always find a way of protecting itself, right? And like I said, with kissing spine or a dropped shoulder and base of the neck, the spine fuses. Okay, this horse here, an Arab, they have an immense mane of pain tolerance. You can see there is hardly any movement in the back, super hollow in the neck. Don't wait that long. And for sure, don't go just with opinions. There's so many opinions about saddle fitting. There's, on the other hand, very good scientific facts. Lots of measurements have been done from different universities. Why do we have to reinvent the wheel? Why can we not do what our ancestors do? Stop making a horse suffering in silence. Have the saddle fitted the way they always have. Only then you will have perfect shoulder freedom, and you will see the horse demeanor, his movement will increase, it's better, and the true partnership comes. For more information, please visit us on our website, schleese.com. We have a YouTube channel with many more great information. For now, I say goodbye, and I look forward to see you next week.